Good evening. This Tuesday, my name is Darren Bartlett, and we are on The Checkpoint, your program where we bring, personalities that we, put on spot, and we ask them some questions and give us some responses. And today, I am with the new president of the Uganda Law Society, that is Bernard Oundo. It was a hard, actually, contest there. I was following the whole election, but he emerged the winner there. And he's going to be taking the society for the year 2022-2023. Right? Is it
yes.
just 1 year?
Yes.
2022-2023. And with me, it's of course the president, like I said, of the Uganda Law Society, the new one, oh, yet to be sworn in, but still, it's a president. Do we also say president elect?
Yes, president elect, Darren.
Well, another president is just being sworn in just in the neighborhood here in Kenya. But anyway, good evening, Bernard. How are you doing today?
Good evening, Darren. It's good to host me here, and a good evening to the viewers. I am glad to be here, looking forward to sharing what the plan looks like ahead and to discuss issues of national importance.
Including those that, especially law issues,
yes.
because that's where we normally run to. They say that if you don't have a doctor, actually three people you need, a doctor, a police officer, and your parent. Once you have those three, you're able to succeed there. But now the issues of law, we have you here. Anyway, Mr. Bernard, tell us about your election. How did it go, first of all? Just from a lighter side of it, how did the whole, process go?
It was a long and tiring one, and a very humbling one. We had to canvass votes of about 4,000 lawyers. This year, 2,000 lawyers voted. That's a very high voter turnout. I think in the previous years, we've had about 1,200 lawyers voting. So this year, we had a turnout of over 2,000 lawyers. That, you can imagine, reaching out to 4,000 lawyers and convincing them that you are the best person for the job is an exhausting task. But I'm happy that we are where we are. Yeah. And I'm looking forward to serve the membership of the Uganda.
How many candidates were you?
We're about six. Six candidates, three gentlemen, three ladies. We ran a very good race. The election was transparent and fair, and we also were able to share thoughts and ideas on what each other was bringing to the table.
Okay, congratulations.
Thank you.
But again, speaking of the, the thoughts that you were sharing with them, you had a four-point agenda that you used to gather these elections, convince your fellow advocates to see that you are, you take the hot seat.
Yes.
What were these points, if you were to explain to a layman or some, maybe a young advocate who is just getting into the industry, who is just finishing LDC, that one who wants to get into law school, what were these four-point agendas?
Thank you, Darren. Our four-point agenda was premised on where we are today as a society and where we need to go as the Uganda Law Society tomorrow. And therefore, we focused on four key points. The first one was we need to be a member-centric society. In other words, the Uganda Law Society has about 4,000 members. We need to see how we focus on providing value for the 4,000 members. And how do we intend to do this? We focused on about three issues. One is the issue of a SACCO. We think that it's very important for Uganda Law Society to have a SACCO. A SACCO promotes investment and saving. If you look around the other law societies in the region, and I've been giving an example of the Law Society of Kenya that has a SACCO that was formed in 1986. 36 years now, our Uganda Law Society doesn't have a SACCO. We think that that is one way of being a member-centric membership-centric association and providing value for our membership. The other issue we have looked at under being a member-centric organization is having a benevolent fund. What happens when our members pass on? Do we have a fund that can take care of their of their families? Do we have a fund that can take care of them during sickness? We needed to start focusing on how fast we build our membership. So these are the key issues under the first point of having a member-centric organization. So in our governing, in our executive council, we're going to focus on being a member-based or organization. The second relates to promoting rule of law and fair administration of justice. This is important, Darren, as you can understand as lawyers, rule of law is key for us. If there is no rule of law, how can we practice? So it is important that we promote the vision of rule of law and fair administration of justice. Under this, we are saying that any challenges or to the access of justice must be dealt with, because one, they not only affect the public, but they also affect us as people who in the judicial services sector. So issues like delayed judgments, issues like the current electronic case management system, these are issues that are very pertinent to us as members of the Uganda Law Society. So under focal point number two, we will focus on all these issues that are barriers to access to justice. The third point, Darren, regards expanding and protecting our legal space. Now, Darren, for you to be able to understand this, I want you to look at the numbers. Currently, we are 4,000 members of the Uganda Law Society. If you look at the Law Development Center now, I'm aware that right now there are about over 2,000 members at the Law Development Center. 2,000 graduated about a month ago.
And are all hoping to join the same space that you want
to join the same space that we are. So we have to be forward-looking. How do we strategically position our society to be able to look at what the opportunities are today? Are we harnessing the opportunities that are there today? And how do we position the society for those that are joining? So it means that the Uganda Law Society, in the next 2 years, we are going to be 8,000 members. Where are all these lawyers going to go? These are the things that we are looking at. How do we create the opportunities so that when they come into the field, they have something to do? And so under that, we are saying we need to focus on the emerging areas of the law. Right now, if you look at the government is focusing on infrastructure. Therefore, you're asking for people to be construction lawyers. You're asking for people to be project finance lawyers. You're asking people to be mining lawyers. You're asking people to be energy lawyers. How do we get this skill set so that those who are joining today can be able to use these opportunities so that they can be able to progress in the profession?
Do you have seminars where you go and empower most of these, or you leave them to find their footing where they can get some money, quick money, because that's what they believe lawyers are, it's to get into the market and get quick money?
Yeah, so if you look at the legal sector now, most people practice land law.
Yes.
So anything to do with transfer of land and ABCD. The other sector is company law, formation of companies and issues to do with companies. The other is family law. Family law deals with divorce, it deals with children, custody of children. Those are the three important sectors where most of the membership is.
Run to. And you avoid criminal law?
And criminal law, because you have the state, which is the DPP, and then you have the number of lawyers in criminal law are not so many. That's also important. We need to look at how we help lawyers that defend criminals because the government has actually the DPP. Mm. So what about the other side? If you're a criminal, can we be able to look at that and also say we need to find a way that the state funds those who defend criminals? There is a state brief system, yes, but we need to empower it more. We need to finance it more. But going back to my point, so if you have people who are practicing land, company, and family law, and then you have all these emerging areas, it means you need to do two things. One, we need to work with academic institutions to see that the emerging areas are being introduced into the curriculum. That's the first point. The second is that we need to ensure that our continuous legal education is taking into consideration the emerging areas, so that our lawyers are empowered to advise on mining, our lawyers are empowered to advise on construction, our lawyers are empowered to advise on taxation, our lawyers are empowered to advise on the emerging areas of the law. That way, we are creating opportunities for our membership.
You know what? You've actually triggered my mind, and this is not the first time that such a question has always come up. I'm very sure even my producer would be wondering. Mm. If you talking about you want a speedy trial, you want to see that you help people, you know, get justice,
yes,
but the advocates or the lawyers are avoiding the area of criminal law, okay? So we see people rotting in prisons. Without mentioning names, I know people who have been in prison for 1 year, others 2 years. In fact, others find out they discharged or they dismissed the case after they've spent years in prison. But people don't seem to understand the importance or where does Uganda Law Society come in to kind of help these people who are there if you're all avoiding criminology.
That's a very good point, Darren, but the Uganda Law Society has actually carried out a system to help those who are in prison to be able to get out. I think in the last 2 months, the past government, the past executive council has actually...
The one that was led by Fiona Wall.
By Fiona Wall, has actually led a project called Decrowding the Prisons. So they have actually been able to do that. So we will continue with that mandate. So it is not that we as Uganda Law Society, we have ignored those issues of concern, which are very important to the public. We are going to continue that mandate because that is within our mandate as Uganda Law Society.
So are you going, you're going to continue with that project?
Yes.
Okay. So let's go to something that you said, because you said you wanted, you're trying to empower the young advocates to join, you know, or to practice the law when they come to your field.
Yes.
But there's always an element of big cut, small cut, the court, they believe it's alleged that the magistrates or the judges or the bench usually chooses to work with the prominent lawyers, the big lawyers, and then you leave out the guys who are just starting because you bully them. You, the big guys, bully the small guys. How are you going to solve that issue of, you know, segregation among advocates?
I think, Darren, it is not that the judiciary picks on who represents the clients.
When they see Counsel Bernard, they say, so they start with Bernard and then Darren, who is not known.
I don't think that is true. But the one point I agree with you is that, yes, there may be some sort of segregation between young and senior lawyers, and that is the fourth point of our fourth point, and we are saying that we want to create a thriving law society for all levels. The Uganda Law Society is a microcosm of the population in Uganda. 70% of the members of the Uganda Law Society are young lawyers. What does that mean for us as the leaders? It means we have to be deliberate at seeing how we provide opportunities for our young lawyers, but also seeing how we can be able to ensure that the services we provide for young lawyers are actually discounted. For instance, our continuing legal education program should be able to have discounted offers for our young lawyers. That said, it is important for us to be together. United we stand, divided we fall. So it's going to be critical under our point number four to ensure the unity, to ensure that there is no division between young and senior lawyers, to ensure that we are actually meeting the needs, the specific needs of our young and senior lawyers.
Interesting, fair point there.
Yes, yes.
I want us to look at the ethics of lawyers or advocates. And most of the times, probably money takes over maybe a moral judgment in this case where you have, because the poor cannot afford an advocate, or even when an advocate is representing the poor, and then because the rich is on the other side, the brown envelope passes, and then an advocate abandons a poor one just to go aside to take sides with the one who can afford justice, probably afford justice under, I don't know, something like that. How are you going to ensure that the advocates discharge their duty fairly without looking at people's pockets necessarily, whether they can afford them or not?
I think that is important. We have what we call the Law Council that is supposed to deal with ethics of lawyers. In case an advocate is unethical, the members of the public have a duty to report to the Law Council. But I think what is key for us as the Executive Council is to continue the appeal to our members to ensure that they are practicing ethically. But the other point of concern that you raise is what the Uganda Law Society does. So the Uganda Law Society is supposed to help the less vulnerable in society. So we have what we call a pro bono fund. Pro bono means that you provide legal services for free. Now, the challenge that we have today is that the pro bono fund has been supported by DGF, whose funding has come to an end. So it's going to be very pertinent for us as the new council to find ways of mobilizing financing, of mobilizing sources of funds for the pro bono fund so that we can assist the less vulnerable, the poor in our society to be able to access to justice. Because that is a very critical mandate for the Uganda Law Society. It is what gives the Uganda Law Society the preeminence in society. It's what gives the Uganda Law Society the purpose to help the less vulnerable and the poor.
We've seen officers of court involved in issues like land, especially land. And at the end of the day, you see that the people, you know, the ones, the poor ones are the ones suffering because, again, the lawyers are taking sides in issues of land. How are you going to solve this issue of officers, law officers, getting involved in such issues?
I think the issues around land grabbing and officers getting involved in land is a very pertinent issue. There are two issues that we must look at. One is respect for court orders. Mm-hmm. If you have a dispute over land, please go to the courts. If the courts give a decision, can we respect the court order? At least I have heard the Attorney General also issue a circular calling upon every law enforcement agency to respect court orders. Because the only way we can deal with these land disputes is subject them to the court. Subject them to the court, let the evidence be heard by the judge, let the decision be made, and let people then respect court orders. The issue of RRDC's interfering in respect for court orders is a very big concern for us as members of the Uganda Law Society. We can't have two courts. We can't have the court where we go to that is empowered by the Constitution and then have the RRDC's also as a second court.
Eventually also people create one, people's opinions court.
People opinions court. So we have one court. If we have disputes, let's go there. If the court makes a decision, let the decision be respected by everyone. That way you deal with it. The second, of course, is to increase the efficiency of the High Court Land Division. The number of disputes there, we need to ensure that they're being dealt with expeditiously to ensure that all decisions are being dealt with and then these land disputes are being settled. I think in my view, as Uganda Law Society, those are the two issues we will need to push for.
But you see, most of the times people are saying that, you know what, Uganda Law Society, all they do is come out and, you know, just speak on media or sometimes go to conferences and just have a good cup of coffee and then, you know, criticize the actions of these RRDCs without doing anything, especially when, let me bring you to an issue of human rights, okay? People are beaten, journalists are beaten, but you know what? Members of the law society just come out and say, you see, that is not allowed, we condemn, but you don't do anything about this. You don't go and petition, you know, the actions of the people who are actually abusing this human right. Why?
I think, yes, in some instances we have given statements, but we also must appreciate that in other instances we have actually petitioned the courts. Now, in issues to do with human rights violations, there's even a very recent judgment that I think was issued yesterday or last week by Justice Kidudu, where the court has stated that in issues of human rights violation, if you're tortured, for instance, if you're tortured, the court has a right to acquit you. So if the police comes and tortures you before they present you to court, and you present to the court that actually you have been tortured, you don't actually even need medical evidence. The court will acquit you right away. Such decisions are very important for respect of human rights. You know, as you're aware, we have different legislations now. We have the Human Rights Enforcement Act, which are providing very important solutions to the current issues that we face. Now, in terms of Uganda Law Society, we will not stop at issuing statements only. We are going to do what we call strategic litigation. In the event that our statements are not being responded to, we are going to litigate over these matters because that is our mandate as Uganda Law Society. We are mandated to advise the government on issues of the law. And if they do not take heed on what on the statements that we have issued, we will litigate over some of these issues so that we have court decisions that actually place the responsibility where it is supposed to be.
You know, still connecting to that, there's this public interest litigation.
Yes.
That we've always thought that you, the advocates, have read the law, you know what to do. Us, we just assume, or maybe objectively or subjectively, we think something must be done this way. But we think that the council should always sit down and look at the position of the law, where it is, what it is right now, what it's supposed to be, or the members of parliament probably are passing something wrong. Why don't you always come out as the council and say, you know what, this law is, should be in interest of the public, and then you go ahead and, you know, file the case, or if it's not a case, it's probably, what would I call it? Basically, a case of interest to the public. Why don't we see this from the society? Like, you're so silent on some things until probably someone raises it, someone goes through it.
I think the society has been active in matters of the law, and when the law is being promulgated, we have shared our opinions.
And you stop
bill,
at that?
On the bill, but you can't challenge a bill because
it's not yet. What if it's already passed?
Yeah, if it's already passed, like, for example, I think if I remember the public order management bill, there are members of the society that challenge the public order management bill, if you recall well. So it is important for the society to be able to take that active participation. I think that currently what you have now is I think the media electronic amendments that are coming through now. Those are also now issues of concern to us, issues that criminalize hate speech. You know, these are issues we are looking at to see how we can be able to challenge such legislation when it comes up. So the Law Society is mandated to take that action. And as part of our mandate, we are going to be able to take that action and be proactive about it. And I agree with you, we must be proactive about it. There could be instances where we've not been proactive in the past, but we're going to be proactive about some of this legislation to ensure that we are challenging the constitutionality of that legislation, so that the law is in public interest, to ensure that the law is actually is in public interest.
Do you have a desk in Parliament as Uganda Law Society? The reason I ask this is sometimes we hear of bills that actually go through Parliament, and you're thinking, oh, Jesus Christ, are we really going through this? Especially things to do with the Computer Misuse Act, which has been amended, and now probably if it's been assented to, it's going to become law. What defines hate speech in there? And some of those clauses that one would think, I think this is a matter of interpretation based on who is on the other side. Do you have an office, first of all, in Parliament? And what do you do when such bills are now tabled? Because you said, you just give opinions, you can't give... Is there a way you can counter some of the things, approach the members of parliament and talk to them about some of these things?
Yeah. Darren, that is happening. That is happening. There is no legislation that passes in this country that is important to the law that the Uganda Law Society is not called upon to give its opinion of. So the parliamentary legal committee is always calling upon the Uganda Law Society to share its views on bills before the House. So that is done. However, we do not determine then eventually what happens. Either sometimes our opinion is taken, sometimes it's not taken. Now, for the computer, it's called the Computer Misuse Amendment, we shared views as Uganda Law Society. If it is suddenly amended, we will be able to challenge it, depending on how it has been assented to. So these are issues of concern, and we know that as Uganda Law Society, it is our mandate to challenge laws of that nature. You can't challenge the bill now because it hasn't been assented to. It's not law now. So you have to wait for it to be assented.
Why?
You have to wait for it to be assented to. You can't challenge it. If you went to court and said, I want to challenge a bill, the court will tell you, but it's not law yet. Who does it apply to?
Can you write to the speaker and go to the speaker and say, we notice you're discussing such a bill, you're proposing to see that it passes, but we want to come in here, right here, and give you guidance. Because let me tell you something, and I'm sure you know it.
Yes.
The composition of parliament, most of the times, very few of them have done law.
Yes.
They can interpret, they know how to form the law.
Yes.
most of them have done different stuff. They don't understand this whole issue of interpretation.
Yes.
Why should we wait to waste taxpayers' money for them to go and consult and do whatever they're doing, sit meetings, and yet you could have just walked in there and said, please, don't go ahead with this law. It doesn't make sense.
Yes, and Darren, we share our opinion. We actually share our opinion. But you see, it is part of the parliamentary process that views are called upon from even other membership associations to share their views on particular legislation. So yes, we have shared our views on the legislation, okay? But then after that, it is taken to the floor and debated and passed and then assented to. Now, once we have shared our opinion, we will wait for them to assent to it. If they assent to it in the manner in which we advised against, then at that point we have a duty to go to the courts and challenge it. The reason you can't challenge it before it is law, it is because it doesn't apply to anyone. It's not yet law yet.
Yeah.
So if you go to court and say, I am challenging the amendment and it hasn't been assented to, it is not law yet. So you have to wait for it to be assented to, and then you can be able to challenge it.
Okay, yeah, let's hope so, because we've seen laws actually that are passed. Even the most recent one, if I remember so well, it's the tenants, you know,
landlord-tenants.
The landlord-tenants, you know, act, which is now a law.
Yes.
And tenants feel like they're oppressed in this, but the landlords are saying, this is it, we got you. But there's nothing has been done from the Uganda Law Society to say no. Mr. President, before you assent to this, let's discuss this issue and we give you our side of view why a tenant should not go through such a thing. So hopefully you will we will hear. Maybe I've now put in my submission, you're going to work on that, on a landlord and tenant stuff. But anyway, you're still watching The Checkpoint. I just want us to take a short break, and then in return, we're still with Bernard Oundo, the new president of the Uganda Law Society, and we're looking at how the Uganda Law Society is going to change the system, probably how humans are handled, or human rights issues and the rest. Let's get a break.